to order. Please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance.
Pledge of Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you all. See if I get an opportunity to look at the minutes from March 13th, 2017.
I make a motion to approve the minutes of Monday, March 13th, as written. Sorry.
Okay, I got a motion, I have a second. Got a second? Second. I was kind of hoping. Do I have a second?
Yeah.
Okay, I have a second. Any other discussion concerning the minutes from March 13th, 2017? I see none. John?
Yep.
Julie?
Abstain.
Doug?
I'll abstain.
Diane?
Yes.
And I vote yes as well. Chief, welcome back.
Mr. Chairman, thank you.
I'm sure you hope you had a good time.
Yes.
And you learned a lot.
I did. It was a long 10 weeks.
But was it worth it?
Extremely worth it, yes.
It's all that matters.
The training was absolutely amazing. Couldn't have been asked for anything better. It's the equivalent of doing a semester of graduate courses. The courses are taught by a certified through the University of Virginia.
Yep.
So upon graduation, the FBI released a press release.
Mm-hmm.
There was 227 of us from around the world, 48 states, 25 countries. So as it reads, including class of members of law enforcement agencies from the District of Columbia, 25 international countries, 3 military organizations, 8 federal civilian organizations. Internationally known for its academic excellence, the National Academy Program held at FBI Academy offers 10 weeks of advanced communication, leadership, fitness training for selected officers having proven records of professional within their agencies. On average, these officers have 21 years of experience, usually return to the agencies to serve in executive level positions. Director Comey of the FBI was principal speaker at the ceremony. Training for the program is provided for by the FBI instructional staff, special agents, and other staff members holding agents or advanced degrees, many of whom are recognized internationally in their fields of expertise. Since 1972, the National Academy students have been able to earn undergraduate and graduate credits from the University of Virginia due to the acceleration by the University of the, or accreditation, sorry, by the University of the many courses offered. Graduating officers were represented by the class spokesman, John J.T. Taylor, Assistant Chief, Dallas-Fort Worth Airport Police, Texas. To date, there are approximately 49,913 graduates now representing the alumni of the FBI National Academy since it began in 1935.
Wow.
So when we all arrived on January 9th, you figure you had 227 of us walking through the doors of the National Academy. I had previously selected my courses when I went down, and I selected the courses that I felt would be more beneficial to my position here, mm-hmm, with the town of Templeton. They offered courses in anti-terrorism, high-tech cyber crimes, Different things that we don't really need here. So my area of expertise was stress management and law enforcement, managing organizational change and development, advanced psychology of communication, seminar and media, and managing the law enforcement image, and essentials for the law enforcement executive. So basically what I was looking at doing is, being that I'm fairly new to being a chief, I wanted to better my leadership skills for the community and for the town and for my employees. So as we get to the academy, we come walking in. You can see it's set up like a normal college. That's a dormitory that's off to the left there. The building straight ahead, that is the cafeteria building right there. That is the quad that goes in between the two dormitories and the library. Everything is secured. So all the doors are secured. You walk around with a lanyard. On your lanyard is your ID, keypad, and your pad for meals. The only time you go outside is when you would walk in between the quad or if you went out to PT. You can see the dormitories there. Normal dormitories, just like college. Two twin beds, desk, armoire. You shared a bathroom with the two other suite mates. One shower, one toilet, two sinks. It was rather interesting for 10 weeks. The whole entire campus, like I was saying, is all secured. So we never go outside except for the quad. You walk from building to building in these glass hallways. Everything's connected. And on an average, we would do anywhere from 6 to 7 miles a day just walking from classes and back and forth from the cafeteria. It's really, when you have to go back, I was in the military, so I'm kind of used to being structured like this, but when you're told that breakfast is every morning at 6 and it goes to 8, lunch is every day from 11 to 1, and dinner's every night from 5 to 7, and that's it. Our days started, I was up every morning at 4:45. We were in class by 7:30, classes ran every day until 4:45. After classes, we had enrichment, which various speakers came in to address us on different things from leadership to handling a mass suicide. There was the one in Wisconsin at the mosque. So every day was planned. Every night, we probably didn't go to bed until 11 o'clock at night, back up at 4:45 in the morning.
Last of the day.
Typical hallway down in the dorms. This is the field house, so we would have to walk. It was probably a mile from where our dorm was out to the field house. You can see our track. Inside there, we do a lot of our physical training. You were broken up into sections. I was in section 3, and that's based off of where you picked your classes. So because I had PT picked in the middle of the day on my C block, I was in section 3. And you'd go out on your with your sections when you had PT. So when we first arrived, oh, that's our laundry room. had to do our own laundry.
Oh wow.
As you can see, I wanted to wear this is my uniform. This is what I wore every day, Monday through Friday. I started off with the green polo shirt, and then once you reach week 8 and you're gonna graduate, they give you the black polos to wear, and it has our section on it. It was very hard getting a washer and dryer. If you can imagine, there's 227 of us. There's also a class of new agents going through at the same time. There could be two classes going through, one just showing up, one graduating. There's a class of analysts going by or going through at the same time. Their uniform is a little bit different. It's khaki pants with a blue shirt with a different colored lanyard. Ours was a green and white lanyard so they can identify who you are. So you have all these people walking through this complex. Try getting a meal when you're all released at the same time. You have over 600 people trying to hit that cafeteria.
Learn to run fast.
Yeah. We would beg our instructors to let us out early. This is physical training on one day. We were actually blessed with some good weather when we were down there. it never, a couple days it almost hit 80. It never really dropped below 35, 40. All our challenges, so when you show up on week one, that Wednesday, you have to run the 1 mile. And for a male, you have to run it in under 10 minutes. For a female, it's under 11. If you don't pass the mile that first week, you can't participate in any of the challenges. We would have a challenge every single Wednesday morning. Now, the challenge was based off of, because one of the main features of the academy is you get a yellow brick. And the yellow brick is from the yellow brick road. It's a 6.1 mile obstacle course designed by the Marines. They have rope ladders and all kinds of stuff. You rappel down the face of a mountain, you climb up the side of the thing, and the challenge is get you ready for the yellow brick road. So you start off with the Tin Man's Run, you have the Winged Monkey Assault, you have the witches, the Wicked Witch Hunt. They're all named after it. The Winged Monkey Assault, that was a killer. You had to do 267 exercises in 30 minutes.
Oh my God.
So you went nonstop around that track for 30 minutes.
So what happens if you are a desk person and never get off your dead butt? You show up there and you don't go.
So if you don't pass the mile run, you don't get to participate in the challenges. So on those Wednesdays, what they would do is they would take them in and run them through to increase their stamina, to increase mm-hmm. their run. We actually had my roommate was one of them. He didn't pass, and he reduced his run by a minute 34, and he lost over 20 pounds while he was there.
Wow.
Their training is, it's called functional movement. It's designed specifically for law enforcement. They want, when you work out, you do a full body workout, and it's all functional exercises. It's not just going in and curling weight or bench pressing weight. It's so that you can perform your job fully functioned. Because we sit behind a desk, a lot of us, as we get up as executives. The class went out for the Law Enforcement Memorial in Washington, D.C. There we are lined up. We had a ceremony. We got to go out, look around everything. We presented a wreath. That's my roommate right there, the one in the front presenting the wreath. And then we had the honor guard from Arlington. And so that is, we got to go up. Anybody that was in the session was able to go up and present the names. So we actually have an officer, his name's Norman Bliss, who died in the line of duty in 1974. And that is probably the first time his name was ever read at the Law Enforcement Memorial. So we got up and did the end of watch date for all our officers. We had the bagpipe. And that's it for the slideshow, because there is so much, but I just wanted to touch on, so we have four major events that take place when we're there. We have what is called patch and pin night. So all the officers from around, well, not around the world, but all the United States officers are there. They hand out patches, pins to all their agencies. You meet everybody with your business cards. The next night is you have flag night. Flag night is really unique, because what it is you go up into the CAF, and it's a big square room like this, and around the outside of the walls is a flag for every single state. So what you do is you go up and you stand underneath your flag, and then they bring up the FBI agents that are graduating that are going to be coming to your state. So you get to meet them. We have international night, which I have so many pictures, but this presentation would have gone for hours. The international students, they show up in their uniforms, their country's uniforms, and they bring something from their country, a beverage, a food, and they're all set up around. You go out and you try everything that's around the world. Let's see, there was goat stew. There was those, you ever hear of those thousand-year-old eggs? Don't try it. they're green, black, and disgusting. But that was from Hong Kong. The girl from Tokyo wrote your name in Chinese, or Japanese, sorry. We had Middle Eastern countries. They had a big, like a big sheep or goat, whatever it was. They were carving that up and having it out for everybody. It was a really, really unique time. Then we have what is called Texas Night, because the state of Texas sends a large contingent to it. And they truck in a barbecue for everybody, and we sit down and they treat us, they serve us, they have raffles. Towards the end, the night of the Yellow Brick Road, that night we had our Yellow Brick Road dinner, and the Yellow Brick Road dinner was Louisiana night. They brought up crawfish and jambalaya and sausage and steamed shrimp. Their sheriff actually drove it. Him and his guys actually drove it from New Orleans to the academy for us. It was a really good time. Director Comey, as I said, was the principal speaker. He was there. Incredible man, very well spoken. He is 6'8", if you've never seen him. I look like a midget compared to this guy. His arm's like this long, and shaking my hand up on stage. Great guy. He actually came out to speak to us another time where we could sit down and we could ask him all the questions that were going on. Did Trump have collusion with Russia during the election?
How were the wiretaps? Huh? How were the wiretaps?
Yeah, how are the wiretaps going? Nothing was off limits. The only thing we couldn't ask about was changing the food in the cap. But, which wasn't bad. It just, after 10 weeks, it kind of gets repetitious. Okay, because we kind of figured out that if you had chicken the night before, there was chicken soup the next day. yeah.
It's like the army. It's nice.
So it wasn't bad. We also had...
Were you from the littlest town?
No, actually there was actually towns smaller than myself. Connections were unbelievable. The networking you make. University of Alabama, Oregon, NC State, Florida, the chief of Sturgis, just people are amazing, talking to everybody. And what they want you to do is every night they expected you to go to networking, because you want to see and learn how policing is throughout the world. And I got to tell you, it's pretty much the same here as it is there. Their problems might just be bigger because it's a bigger community than it is in Templeton. But it's all the same, and you really get a great experience with all these international people. The training is top-notch. I wrote 2 10-page papers, 8 5-page papers. I can't even tell you how many, like, 1 and 2-page papers, 6 group presentations. I took a class, the social media class, or the media seminar in media, was actually dealing with the media. The instructor named Gail Pennybaker used to be on a network, major network in DC. She comes up and she grills you just like you're giving a press conference. We did a press conference, we did a remote interview, we did a regular standing interview. If you've never given a remote interview where you're just staring into the camera, I'm telling you, that's quite unique. It's different, and you have an earpiece on, and you're listening to the questions come down to you, and you got to talk into a camera to respond. It's pretty cool. I got a lot out of it. So academically, I got to tell you, it's probably, I wrote more papers in 10 weeks than I wrote in 4 years of college. I mean, it was tough. But that's pretty much it. If you have any questions, happy to answer anything.
How did you end up getting to go to begin with?
Okay, so back in 2012, I went to what's called FBI Leads, which is a regional training. It's a 1-week training. And I actually learned of the training at that course. I came back, I spoke to Chief Whitaker at the time. And Chief Whitaker actually started grooming me for a chief's position back in 2012. I had already started going to executive trainings. I started leadership schools. So I had to apply. And there are actually, when I went to orientation in Boston, it's actually in Chelsea, sorry. when I went to orientation, they tell you that if they stopped the waiting list right now for the National Academy, it would take 9 years of 4 academies a year to exhaust the waiting list. There's only 1% of all law enforcement in the world that will ever have this training. There's only 2 currently in this area, that's Chief Albert and Chief Larry Barrett in Ashburnham, that are in this area. Both are retiring within the next 3 years. And the chief from Berlin are the only 3 chiefs that I know, now me being 4, in this whole area that even have the training. Speaking to FBI Boston, for some reason, chiefs from, I think I'm like the farthest west chief that has had this training. Chiefs from Western Mass don't put in for it. There's only 7 slots for New England that get to go to the academy. So there's only 7 people in all of New England that they choose from that can actually go. So I was on the waiting list for 4 years to go to this.
Great. You guys have anything?
I have a question.
Yes.
Would you be willing to come to the high school and maybe present some of this information to some students that are...
Yeah, I'll actually do a better presentation too. It was like, I was so busy. I thought I could really get it done quicker when I got back, but I've had so much to get caught up on. I was kind of like on a back burn.
Understood.
So I could get caught up. But yeah, I would love to.
Yeah, I'd like to talk to you about that. I think
okay.
It would be good experience.
Absolutely.
For some of the kids.
It might be nice for you to, in conjunction with Steve Castle, create something to be on the community television as well.
Yeah. Christina and I actually met this morning. We had a very lengthy conversation, so she's going to do a newspaper article for it, too. So,
great.
Yeah. Congratulations to you.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
Welcome back.
Thanks for the presentation.
Yeah, that was awesome.
Brief, but.
I want to see some of those pictures, though. I know. I'll give you a call.
If you need help, you've got connections.
Right.
Absolutely.
Appointments.
Yeah, I'll try to get down there.
I see Mandy here, but
yeah.
So are the, I just have a question. Are
yes,
the other 3 people who were on the town administrator's screening committee, are they staying on?
Mm-hmm.
My person was not.
No, I haven't heard back yet. The other 3 are working on.
Did you check to Mr. Hanks? I thought he was.
I haven't. You guys just spoke to him.
Yeah, he said he was good to go.
Oh, he was going to?
Yes.
Oh, okay. We can put him on next time.
Okay.
So do they, did we just, so we have to reappoint everyone, correct?
But I talked to my person, he's not interested in continuing.
Okay.
I have reached out to someone else who I thought would be interested, but we would like to see younger folks get in. So I have one more person that I'd like to contact. And I'll hopefully have them ready by next time.
Okay, because right, we agreed there was going to be 5 on the committee.
Mm-hmm. Each one of us was picking someone.
Okay.
And I know that my previous person was not available.
Okay.
And I contacted Brian.
But you chose someone, right? So.
And yeah, he's agreed to do this.
Mandy, if you'd like to, if you don't mind, John,
mm-hmm.
If you'd like to come up. Does everyone know Mandy Vassell, the new principal of the high school?
How are you?
Good, how are you?
Good, thank you.
You know me, I'm Diane Haley Brooks.
I'm Doug Morrison.
John Kaplis.
Julie Richard.
John Columbus.
We've met before.
Yes, we have.
I chose Mandy, not unlike Dr. Cassavan, who just recently went through
mm-hmm.
a screening process for the job that they had. So I also, you know, in case some of the public doesn't know who you are as well. So I just wanted to introduce you.
Thank you.
Well, thank you for stepping up and taking this responsibility.
Sure.
It's really a great opportunity.
Thank you.
Okay, so
Do you want me to just do these and,
Sure.
Yeah, I make a motion to appoint Mandy Vassell and Brian Rosengren to the Town Administrator Screening Committee until the completion, of their tasks.
I have a motion, I have a second.
Second.
I have a motion, a second, any discussion concerning these two? I see none, John?
Yes.
Julie?
Yes.
Diane?
Yes.
Doug?
Yes.
And I vote yes as well. And obviously, three other people we can, for next meeting, I would assume, or, okay.
I just wanted to let you know, Carol Harris is down in her office, if you wanna get sworn in before she leaves at 7:30.
Is it possible to get those people sworn in sooner than the next meeting?
Yeah, you can go down there to get sworn in.
We're gonna do the other appointments tonight though, aren't we, so that they can get sworn in?
Once again.
Room down in the hall.
Yes.
Oh, okay.
You can.
Oh, you mean the others on the screening committee? Thanks, Mandy.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you.
As far as the poll and the race.
Yeah, you meant the other people on the screening committee.
The three screening committees.
Oh, okay, so that we'll, okay.
But we have to do that pretty quick though.
Sorry, yeah, we do.
When's our next, we have a workshop?
Your next business meeting is April 10th.
We need to get those three people done before then. Have you talked to Collins?
We have not.
Okay.
I do think they were anticipating that the committee would be in place.
Before April 1st, right?
At least by, or almost immediately following the closure date.
Right.
Which is April 1st.
Yeah, right.
So can we call it special?
This time around, it was open until filled, but they were trying to do the first review right around April 1.
So it has been posted again then?
Yes.
And the changes that we wanted made, because we never actually had a meeting with, Collins or Dick, was that communicated so that the posting was changed to be more specific?
I thought we had forwarded that to you from Collins, and we'll certainly do that tomorrow morning. They made the changes with respect to, the salary with an open until, filled, but where review begins date, and referred to the 4 days, which we thought might prove attractive to some people.
Right.
So should we call a special meeting to get this committee formed quicker than April 10th? I'm a little confused on this, because we thought we were all well aware to check with our person.
Yep.
If they showed no interest, to seek out someone else in the community that was willing to do this so that we could get this done at this particular meeting.
Mm-hmm.
So we reached our deadline of April 1st. Am I
well,
wrong
it was never
here?
Communicated that it would be this meeting that we had to have it done by.
Okay.
We got a simple email that said,
check with them that we'd be on the next Board of Selectmen meeting, correct?
That. It did not say that.
Okay.
Well, I think that normally you don't take formal votes in
a workshop. That's what we've been having.
I don't see why, since basically you're sort of ratifying everybody's individual choices. That couldn't be the first item Monday evening.
All right, let's plan on that then.
Did you say that Richard Hanks, sorry.
Yep.
I'm like, he was staying on?
Yes.
Okay, but did we dissolve the other committee or?
It was
did.
Dissolved, yes.
Okay, so is there a reason that we can't appoint Richard Hanks tonight and then we only need to appoint two people?
We can do that.
Because his name's not on here. Maybe you just weren't aware, Holly, that he was going to stay on.
But if you're.
Yes.
Confident, yeah.
Yeah, I'm confident.
Okay, so I make a motion to appoint Richard Hanks to the Town Administrator Screening Committee until the completion of their tasks.
A motion, a second.
Second.
I have a motion, a second, any discussion? See none. John?
Yes.
Julie?
Yes.
Diane?
Yes.
Doug?
Yes.
And I vote yes as well.
There's also, I make a motion to appoint Rayanne Trifolo, and I cannot say this name, Sue Kartowski, as poll workers for elections with a end date of June 30th, 2017, and for Sheila Tallman for registrar with an end date of April 20th, 2017. She's only going to be a registrar for a month?
Yeah, it's just for the
Because you fill the balance of the term.
Oh, okay. So
I
make those three motions.
I got the motions.
Sorry,
I have a
I didn't
second.
Know if I was reading that wrong.
No, you got it right. That motion, I have a second.
Second.
Okay, a motion and a second. Thanks, Doug. Any other discussion concerning Mr. Pillow Ms. Ski and Ms. Tallman. I see none. John?
Yes.
Julie?
Yes.
Diane?
Yes.
Doug?
Excuse me, yes.
And I vote yes as well. So the two will be, the two other for the screening committee will be on Monday, first thing on the agenda. And next on the agenda is the extension of the interim town administrator's contract.
Mr. Chairman, I would request that you take that vote after the executive session.
Okay. Any other town election warrant?
I thought we did this. Did we not, Holly?
No, we haven't done this one.
You had a draft in your budget book, and it had a placeholder for a capital exclusion vote.
This is just the election warrant.
Yes, but the consensus from the budget meeting the other night, and I don't know, Doug, if you want to speak to this, was that we would not have that capital exclusion question. And therefore, we prepared this warrant.
Right, and the town meeting warrant. But this is the election warrant that just talks about.
No, it would be, we can't.
This is just for the election.
Right.
So there'll be no question on it, is what
you're
saying.
That was the consensus.
Okay.
That was the consensus from the other night.
Okay, I understand that.
If you've rethought that, then we need to back up and quickly prepare a question.
No, I agree. Since, you know, since you found funding for capital within the budget, that certainly makes more sense than requesting a separate debt exclusion article.
So with that consensus having been reached the other night, we went ahead and prepared the election warrant.
So we're making a motion to post this. Approve it.
Approve and post.
Approve it and post it, yeah. Okay, so I make a motion to approve the election warrant of May 1st, 2017, and for it also to be posted.
I have a motion and a second.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any discussion concerning the posting of the warrant? I see none. John?
No.
Julie?
Yes.
Diane?
Yes.
Doug?
Yes.
And I vote yes as well. Insurance advisory policy effective by FY18 rates.
Mr. Chairman, I would ask that you refer this report of the Insurance Advisory Committee to your budget meeting Monday night, that you might spend a bit more time discussing the impact on it on the overall budget. I don't know if you know, if it's your desire to act on it tonight, but that would be my suggestion.
Are we allowed to overturn this?
You have 30 days in which to consider their report. And yes, you do not have to follow their recommendation. And I will get you the statute on that for Monday night.
Okay. And 13.3 is definitely the increase?
13.3 is the MIA increase. It's the top of the scale that they have at this year. We did prepare in your budget book and in the report of the committee, there were some other tweaks around the edge. I mean, they weren't dramatic.
Right.
There were some others that came up at the last meeting. Was that last Wednesday? I forget. I think it was last Wednesday. There was one or two more that were inquired about, but we can certainly have that spreadsheet ready and, you know, tell you what the impact is of these. If there's something else you'd like us to look at over the next few days, certainly we can look into that as well.
What the impact of the employees are going to be. So we can move this to Monday? Is that okay with everybody?
Well, the impact to employees would be based on what is written in here?
Mm-hmm.
Or would there be more impact to them besides what the suggestions were for each one? There's a motion to recommend increasing the copay for ER from $50 to $100,
mm-hmm.
and office visit copays from $15 to $20,
mm-hmm.
which overall, and increasing prescription costs, which would reduce the premium increase to 8.9%.
Right.
Is there going to be more of an impact than those two things? Three things, I'm sorry, prescriptions too.
And the ER
I mean, to go from 13.3 to 8.9 and...
with all those increases.
Okay, I pay $100 for a copay, but I don't... It encourages you not to go to an ER any longer. And if you go to urgent care, it's treated as a doctor visit. And not an urgent care visit. And my office copays are actually more than 20. And I'm not comparing that to me, but what I'm saying is there more impact than these on the employee?
No.
Well, there's the premium impact. So there's two impacts. There's the cost out of each weekly paycheck, and that gets balanced against the out-of-pockets. And when you get a chance to look at the budget, you'll see what we tried to do was to show, okay, so if you make this change, how much do you save and what does that mean about how many times you would go to the emergency room before you truly went out of pocket?
Mm-hmm.
We did the same on the office visit. We didn't do that on the scripts because, frankly, it came up at the last minute. And it's impossible to project without knowing what drug regimen every person might be on.
So I guess it would be best to see all of the impact.
That's what I would think. So Monday, what do you think, Doug?
Julie?
Mm-hmm.
John, Monday?
Yeah, Monday.
Right. That way we have the budget in front of us and we can actually see the offset and see how much changes the employees are going to feel.
And it'd be interesting to know, too, what the percentage would be if we just did the 50 to 100 and the 15 to 20 and didn't include the prescriptions.
Those are all in your budget books.
Okay.
If you get a chance to look,
I went to that thing with a fine tooth
comb. Starting, if anyone wants to note this, on page 250, we have a couple pages of if you go from 50 to 75, what's that new premium? What does that save the employee if you go from 50 to 100? So there's a number of permutations there to look at on pages 250 and 251.
Great. So Monday, thank you. Declaration of surplus property. Mr. Tenzini.
We have an employee who's left us, a long-serving employee. They had a town-issued cell phone, which is, for all practical purposes, close to obsolete at this point. It's got a value of $50 or less, I'd say. We gave you some eBay things. We have generally not tried to recover this type of personal property from the employees, you know, T-shirts, vests, things like that.
Right.
They've asked if they might keep it, so we've brought forward this request to you. You would have to declare it surplus property in order for us to do that.
So moved.
Second.
Motion is second, thank you. Any other discussion concerning the surplus property? Diane? All right, I see you. John?
Yes.
Yes.
Diane?
Yes.
Doug?
Yes.
And I vote yes as well. Special legislation, validating certain TM actions. Mr. Tenzini?
Mr. Chairman, and Doug's familiar with this issue. He and I have been working on some potential language to amend the bylaw on the capital planning process that we hope will end this kind of continuing problem. The Pleasant Street pump station was not brought before the capital planning committee, and as such, bond council will not sign off on it being in compliance with the bylaws. Therefore, as you've had to do with some other projects, I have drafted special legislation that I'm asking you to submit to the legislature that would validate the vote of town meeting in authorizing this bond, notwithstanding the failure to go through the capital planning process. Now, I know that the sewer commissioners, we've been trying to set up a telephone conference with them with bond council. They do not subscribe to the idea that this is an issue. But while we await that conference call and perhaps bringing them around on that, truly we're just burning time here. The longer it takes to get it to the legislature, the longer it takes for them to get it into the pipeline, consider it, and get it enacted. So I would respectfully request that you authorize the filing of this special legislation in substantially the form as drafted.
So moved.
Second.
Okay. Motion is second. Thank you. Any other discussion concerning special legislation for the town meeting vote?
Is this just for one project?
What's that, ma'am?
Is this just for one project?
This is for the sewer pump station, but obviously all projects from this point forward need to go through the capital planning, which is how it's written in the bylaw.
Okay, so the only question that I have is that it doesn't reference a specific article that was at town meeting. It's generic, or it seems like it doesn't reference like Article 2, or I don't remember the article, but I'm just saying like this is general, like we could do it all the time.
Well, and this is exactly, this is the same language that we used on the police
station.
With the only difference being this, it was called the special instead of the annual, and we had the different date on it.
Okay.
That's kind of boilerplate.
I don't recall that, but.
So in the language, though, it says notwithstanding any general or special law or town bylaw.
Yes.
So the town bylaw is the capital planning bylaw, so why would this not be? Why wouldn't the town bylaw impact this?
Notwithstanding any general or special law or town bylaw to the contrary. So what they're saying is, no matter what else is out there, anything that is in opposition to what may have been required to make this valid is considered, this action that you took at town meeting is considered valid.
Yeah.
It's that to the contrary.
Okay.
Okay, I have a motion and a second. Any other discussion? Yes, Ms. Tilton.
I'm a little confused that we have town bylaws mm-hmm. that aren't always followed. So how do we expect this one to be followed?
The capital planning?
Yeah.
But we need an at-large community member. And the planning board hasn't had a member that would come, and the school committee didn't have a, so we never have a quorum.
Okay.
So even if you come to, they've only been, I'm only looking at Doug, because it's usually Doug and Kate Fulton who come. This is just the first issue, that they can only make a recommendation, but they can't vote, number one. Number two, it's a matter of now we know, so we have to do it. So it's just this was missed, other stuff was missed. Not excusing that, we shouldn't be, but we need to come up with something different. Maybe only three people need to be on the Capitol Planning Committee so that you're not trying to, we can't get volunteers and we can't get people to come. So this is correcting, because it was voted on at town meeting, so we're not just voting on it as a board going, yeah, let's do this, but.
No.
We need to have some policy and procedure, which we don't have right now.
Which you don't follow anyways. That's part of my point.
We're doing the best we can with what we have.
No, I realize that.
And the bylaws need to be followed, that's why they're in place.
That the bylaws need to be followed, your standard.
Yes.
Selectmen operating procedures need to be followed.
Yes.
And there are times that the current board hasn't followed them. So I'm trying to find out what is going to be done to ensure that they are followed. And I think it's a reasonable question.
No, it is, it's very reasonable. And I think obviously some of the responsibility falls on me. I mean, I need to get more boned up on the bylaws themselves. And so I take some of the responsibility. But I think at the end of the day, you know, we all have to follow the same guidelines and rules and regulations that we're governed by here in this community.
Well, there is the first article in the bylaws have a $20 fine for every offense where you don't follow the bylaws.
Right. I understand. Thank you. Any other questions? Yes, Julie.
Since we've done this in the past, the police station,
mm-hmm.
do we know how far along that is on the food chain at the state level?
I don't. Go ahead, Mr.
It's been referred to the community on municipalities and counties. It's awaiting its public hearing. I did check the hearing schedule this morning. It's we are Senate Bill 1136. For tomorrow, they're hearing Senate Bill 1132 and 1150-something, and I don't know exactly how they decide pick which ones, but we have reached out to the senator to try to see if she can help move along the scheduling. They've got 8 or 10 bills up tomorrow. And I'll report to you Monday evening.
Great. Anything else? Yes, ma'am.
I just think it might be a good thing to remind people that we did hire that company to work on the bylaws and to go through them and make sure that the code, you know, that they're being updated, as most of them are way outdated. So that entire process is happening right now with the bylaws, just to kind of keep that at the forefront of the community, you know, committee.
Absolutely.
Community.
Yeah, the codification's going through.
I think that Liz's point was that you can have all the bylaws that you want to, but if the board doesn't follow them,
right.
Then they're just basically just words on a piece of paper. So,
right.
You're right.
But they are being codified right now through a company in New York.
Are those going to be in this town meeting, or is it going to be a special town meeting?
It should take up over a year
plan.
To 3 years.
It's 3 years.
Because some of our bylaws conflict with Mass General Law. So that's a huge problem for us as well. Yes, ma'am.
Did we get a grant to do that?
What's that, ma'am?
Nope. Did this company to do?
No, that was approved out last year.
No, we
August or September at some point, and we broke it up over 3 years to fit it into the budget.
I believe it was $10,000 that was split up over 3 years of payments. It's in the budget. It's in the big book. Anything else? Yes.
And just also, it's not just them working through it, in case you weren't aware of how it's working. That will be, the bylaws will now be online. They'll be searchable. You'll be able to have access to them. As things change, it will be updated. So there won't be where we have to look through books and all of that. It will be updated automatically and have readable access, searchable access. You know, it's a huge process. It's not just
if you have an old book,
Right, exactly. So you can go to the website and it will be current for the town.
But we will have, it's my, we will have books available because not everybody is internet savvy, so we should have that.
Absolutely. Thank you. Anything else? Okay, the motion is second. John?
Who's that, what was the motion?
The special legislation.
Oh, yes.
Julie?
Yes.
Diane?
Yes.
Doug?
Yes.
And I vote yes as well. John, you had some concerns with the old business, the procurement contract policy? You had some concerns with that?
Because of the nature of our past problems, I'm sure that there's going to be suggestions and references made in the management letters to the audits. So I think that taking any action without having that information here is premature.
Okay.
Any action about what?
The procurement and contract policies that you...
I don't have that ready. I have to do, I'm not really sure why it was on this agenda, but that's a huge policy, and I need to be able to speak to the department heads to see how they do things, how are we going to follow, and what are we going to make for rules, what's the number going to be? We're in budget season, so it is definitely, I've already begun some of that research by looking at the contracts and seeing what was there and maybe seeing what went wrong, what's the best place to have it, who should sign the contracts, who should... Oh, I have a ton of notes, but there's no way I could put together a policy in the middle of budget season.
As Mr. Clemens was stating.
And we should, we do need to see the management letter.
But there's no reason to reinvent the wheel, Diane. There are policies out there.
Yes.
Model policies that we can work with that would shave a lot of time and effort off of that.
Although that is true, like the current procurement amounts are 10 and 50,000. In my worldly opinion, 50,000 for a town this size is too large. And I think that the numbers should be reduced to as to when someone should be notified that, you know, you're either purchasing something or having services or, you know, that 50,000, I mean, everybody could be out doing anything that they want to, and I don't think that that's appropriate. So we have to have our own internal policy as well. That's a state level policy. But I'm not I am going to reinvent some of the books. We don't really have an internal policy at all.
I got you.
All right.
Thank you. All right, so we're going to move that on. I'll put that on.
I'll let Holly know when I even have any kind of draft. Again, it's going to take me a little bit of time, and we do need to see the management letter.
Absolutely.
Since I'm sure that will be addressed.
Yeah, sure. Any board and staff comments? Anybody? Yes, Mr. Tenzi.
Mr. Chairman, I distributed to the board earlier this evening what I personally consider to be bad news for the general fund, which is that the school district has under consideration a potential budget that would be up 9.21%.
Yep.
So the original ask was for about $380,000.
Right.
Which was $50,000 above all your new revenues. And the new ask is potentially $515,000 plus or minus, which means we would have to, if that stood, make a cut of another $136,000, give or take, out of the budget. So I would encourage this board to consider sending a message to the district as to what it believes it can afford. And I truly do understand the value of education on the quality of life. My wife reminds me nightly from her role as special education director on the value of education, on the real estate values, the major investment of everyone. At the same time, when you're getting $330,000 and someone is asking for all of that plus 60% more, there simply isn't enough left to patch the roads, plow the streets, protect persons and property, and maintain your other basic functions, let alone provide any sort of other community service. I know this is a message that's not necessarily well received, but I think it's a message that I need to bring to you.
So this worksheet is something different than what was in our budget book?
It is. What was in your budget book was a preliminary budget of March 9. I did balance the town budget against that number. However, after the public hearing last week, when I called the school to say, I asked you to consider cutting the total request of the two towns by $50,000 that we might replace that aging cruiser. I was told that there had been additional items requested and that new numbers would be available this morning. And I did talk with the business manager this morning, and she provided that revised draft to me that you have in front of you.
And this is what they're going with tomorrow and voting on Wednesday, correct?
Well, as I understand it, there's a subcommittee, a budget subcommittee tomorrow night,
yep,
which would then recommend something to the school board Wednesday evening. There would be, they are scheduled to have a public hearing at 6 p.m. And the meeting notice that I saw called for a school committee vote at 6:30 p.m.
Okay. So what any new growth this community has, obviously it's going to the school department, which means we will then be in a deficit of $137 that we need to come off the general fund budget, $137,000.
As I tally the numbers, yes. Now, obviously, so that's all always fluid at this time of the year.
Mm-hmm.
And should there be any reduction in this presentation that I received this morning, obviously that 137 comes down.
Wow.
And the budget that I presented to you is balanced based to the degree that you accept the various assumptions that I laid out that it was made upon.
Based on it being level funded?
Yes.
Well, that's not good news at all. There's no wiggle room in that budget, being level funded. There's no wiggle room. That means departments will have to shut down. Services will have to stop, potentially. Wow. Okay, let's go into executive session. That's pretty good. Excellent.
It is what it is. We have to live within our means.
Got
it. We can get some big fat company to come plank itself.
Yeah. Yeah. It's more than that. I mean, this is way.
I know.
I never even thought that this would even. I'll talk to you after. And this is. I've never seen numbers like this first. I mean,
you should call Dr. Casavant.
Oh my lord. I'm going to be in tears because.
So the budget that we at the school budget subcommittee that was voted when the last time I went were not those numbers, but then when I didn't get to go because we had a workshop.
Yeah.
They voted that they had reduced their E&D down to 53,000. They got rid of a health position along with six other positions, and so the school committee recommended higher number, which I was not aware of.
Wow.
So.
Have you talked to Dr. Casavant? Just the business manager, correct?
I spoke with the doctor towards the end of the week, hoping he was going to share good news of the $50,000 reduction I'd asked for, and learned of the potential of this increase. I was not able to speak with him today.
Can you make an effort? Can you make an effort to do that? And obviously, I'm gonna go to the meeting tomorrow.
I certainly can.
That'd be great. Kelly, did you see these numbers?
No.
Okay. I'll make sure, we'll make sure you get these so you can look at some.
Why are we going into executive session, Mr. Chairman?
We're going into executive session right now.
Yes, but why? You have to tell us why we're going.
Oh, we're going, oh, yes.
Well, and are we coming back into open session? I imagine that we would have to.
Yeah, I think we would have to.
You would have to.
I think we have to.
Would have to.
I would assume that it's.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
So, Mass General Law, Chapter 30 Alpha, Section 21-2 and 21-3, union, non-union negotiations.
Actually, Mr. Chairman, given that the ICE Insurance Advisory Committee matter's been referred, it is only for.
The 21-3?
Negotiations with non-union personnel.
Gotcha. And we will be returning back into open session. Motion?
I won't.
Second? Motion second, any other discussion? I see none. John?
Yes.
Julie?
Yes.
Diane?
Yes.
Doug? And I vote yes as well. Thank you, we will be coming back.